Thanks, Sarah, for putting this all together. I'm going to tell you a little bit about some work. When I moved to Hawaii 2 years ago, I was really excited to start working on some local caves. I'm pretty really complimentary to the work that Christy presented. So to give you an idea of the players in this project up front, so Helena, who was for several years a postdoc at the University of Maryland College Park, she's really interested in the evolution of cave animals, particularly the loss of communication. So she's really the one who initiated this work. She was in the lab with Bill Jeffries, who does a lot of work with cave fish. And then Mirei is someone who works in my lab who's helped out with some of the bioinformatics. What I'm going to present to you today is sort of the very first look at. We just got the data back recently. So the very first pass at some of these studies. So just, I guess, to remind you, for those of you who weren't here for Christy's talk, I'm talking specifically about the tent hoppers. They're perhaps the best characterized in the cave fauna in Hawaii. This is Mike's fantastic picture of one. And these species are indeed truly associated with roots. They live on the roots. They have vibratory signals that they use to communicate by leaves. So when you're looking for tent hoppers, you're looking for roots. Very large root galleries, and they're good for some of these sorts of studies because in caves you have a lot of habitat in there where you have fairly large populations, so you don't have to worry so much about impacting that population if you need to sample a number of species, which is something that, as cave biologists, I worry about a lot. So to take a step back and just tell you a little bit more about why the plant hoppers, Hawaii in general, but specifically the plant hoppers, are an interesting system to ask some of these evolutionary questions that I'm going to tell you about. There are about 80 species described of oleares across the Hawaiian Islands. Most of those are surface species. So there's an example of a surface species. There are, in contrast, about 12 of those are polymorphic species. Oleares polyphemus being the most well known. Those 12 are distributed across at least the Big Island. The largest diversity of species is on the Big Island, which is where the study is focused. And most of those species, as Christy pointed out, are these undescribed genetic lineages that are currently called part of this Olearis polyphemus species complex. So that's one thing that really needs to be teased out in this group. But because they're in the Hawaiian Islands, because we have the surface ancestors, when you're doing evolutionary studies, you have a really good constraint on date, how long these things have had to converge from, how long the habitat has been available, and you can estimate divergence time from surface relatives. As well, we have replicated cave invasions on multiple islands. So it's a really good system. There's also a really good system, the plant hoppers, because we have not only that really troglomorphic cave-adapted Olearis polyphemus species, but some of the species across the other islands have different degrees of troglomorphic features, so different degrees of pigmentation, different degrees of eye loss. So here's just a few of those examples of some of those other species. You can see they have variations in the size of the wing. Unfortunately, there are no images of these other species. We can't really give you a really good comparison. I'll give you the best one I have in a slide or two. The red bits show you, so some of them have reduced eyes, there are other species that have completely lost eyes. So you have this sort of completely troglomorphic sort of intermediate forms, and then we have the surface forms. So we have all of these variations, this phenotypic variation in these troglomorphic traits that we can use to investigate the loss of these characters, all within a well-constrained dated system. So the data I'm going to present to you today are our first look at that. Helena and Bill came over early on, shortly after I got to Hawaii, and we did a concerted effort to try to get some of these cave-adapted Olearis species. We also have two species of surface Olearis, which for right now, until I get better at identifying Olearis species, or species B and species R for black and red. But if you can get these reliably in large number on the surface, Polyphemus, which right now is a species complex, but you can find in many, many caves across the island. And then despite our best efforts, we did try in Maui, weren't very successful. We did get one of the other species of the big island. This is Olearis lurede, named for Loretta Lynn, who's on the cave. And actually, story from Frank and Fred Stone is that she actually went caving with them and they found this species, so they named it after them. So that's pretty cool. So we were able to find this species. Again, there isn't a great, there are no images of any of these other species. The best to show you sort of the variation is, Christy already showed you this image of this plant hopper that we found in the southern part of the island that we think is a new tropomorphic species. When you compare it to surface species, you see that reduction in pigmentation, eye, and wing size. You can see that sort of in comparison to the Polyphemus type. Also, she did mention, it's pretty interesting, it's found in the same cave as the Polyphemus type. So you have both of these species in there coexisting with the pathway. So there's an interesting story there that we're starting to look at. But that's just to give you a look at that variation of pigment, variation in eye size, and then zooming in on that variation of eye size. No eyes, little eyes, big eyes. So the study that I started, that really Helena got started, is looking at how these structures are lost at the genetic level. So the first pass was to go get these species and look at gene expression patterns for genes that are known to be involved in the things that are being lost when you're moving towards that tropomorphic form. So we started this by doing transcriptomic studies of these four species. Transcriptomic studies are basically where you take, we grabbed up the whole animal for each of these multiple individuals, so we had replicates, and then you are sequencing all of the transcripts, so everything that is actively being transcribed in the genome. And then we can compare that across species and not look at not only what is being expressed, but at what level, as a first pass for maybe how things are being turned off. And again, it's valuable because we have these variations in the features that are being lost. Helena's interest is really in pigmentation, and she's been working on that side, so I'm not going to talk to you about that, but with these data we can investigate any place where we have a structure that we know something about the way it works genetically. We can use these data to investigate that. I'm just going to give you an example of that from the area that I study most, which is the evolution of vision, and so looking at this eye reduction across the species, and what does that mean relative to the expression of the genes that are involved in vision. So just to give you a quick background, the most important thing, some might argue, in the visual sensory system is the capturing of photons of light, and that is achieved by visual pigments. That visual pigment is made up of two things, an opsin protein and a light-sensitive chromophore. So those two things together are sensitive to light, and when they detect photons of light, they absorb photons of light, it starts the signal cascade leading to vision. So this is what an optical protein looks like. And one of the ways to assess the visual system is by looking at how many types of options are expressed. For comparison, sort of the insect model system is Drosophila, the fruit fly. The fruit fly has 7 different opsin genes that are known from the genome. 5 of those are found in their compound eye visual system. One of those is known just from their ocelli, the simple eyes that they have sort of on the top of their heads. We still don't know what it does. So that's a mystery, but it's probably not involved in vision. So I took these transcriptomic data I had from these 4 species, and looked specifically for expression of opsin genes, and focusing on those that we know from the fly would be involved in the visual system. So the first pass, this is what I found, and these data is an expression. For the 4 species, all of them express the same 2 types of opsins, RH4 and RH6, so those come across all 4 species. Only the red surface species did I find any expression of an additional opsin, the RH1. And this is surprising for a couple of reasons. of all, that RH1, this is the main opsin used in Drosophila division. So it's got the widest expression pattern. So the fact that they are not using that was surprising to begin with. What they are using, and it seems to be that perhaps plant hoppers that have a different type of visual system just based on genetic data, they all express one opsin that is going to have sensitivity in the ultraviolet range of the visual spectrum, and then they all express a second opsin that was going to have sensitivity in the green spectrum. So it doesn't seem to matter where the species is in this spectrum of eye loss, they all express one ultraviolet and one green opsin, regardless of eye size. The next level of analysis is to look at the levels of expression for each of these genes. So the values here for each of these genes by the species, the values are in transcripts per kilobase million, which is basically just a way to count up, a normalized way to count up how many transcripts on line this data set. So if we look at the RH1, three of those species, we didn't find it at all. For their red surface species, the values are very, very low. So even in the red surface species, we don't have much support for being a major player in the visual system. So we can cross that one out. For the ultraviolet and green sensitive opsins, perhaps not too surprising, but there seems to be variation with the size of your eye and the amount of that opsin that you express. So surface species with large eyes express lots of those opsins. The species that we find in caves express much less. The species without any eyes expresses very little, but it still does express a little of each of those. It's also the pattern of having sort of lower UV opsins to green opsins makes sense just based on the way the eyes and the photo receptors are put together. That's something that's expected. So this pattern is somewhat expected. Why do we still see expression of opsins at all in a species that has no at least external evidence of an eye? Again, these things have probably evolved very rapidly. Remember, the Big Island is less than a million years old, that landmass. And so perhaps the pathway hasn't been completely shut off. Perhaps these transcripts aren't being made into proteins. But they are on the way out, it would appear. Whereas the species with eyes is still expressing some low level of even these visual pigments. And this pattern seems to hold for other proteins that are involved in the visual signal transduction cascade. So opsins are the first part of that cascade. They detect photons and start the signaling. Arrestins are a protein that shut that cascade off. So you can be both an on and an off switch. So these proteins, you see the exact same pattern. They're still expressed, but at low levels in the iris species, and with increasing expression levels to that intermediate form in the surface species. So we're finding sort of expected patterns, at least in terms of expression levels. What next? What can we do with this information? First of all, we have those other pathways to go and look at. And certainly based on other genetic studies, different phenotypes, eyes, pigmentation, are lost in very different ways. So those are going to be interesting to compare. Just based on the data I've shown you today on eye reduction, the genes involved suggest that there's something unusual going on, or at least the plant hopper eyes are put together in a different way than Drosophila eyes, so there's more there to investigate, certainly. We are adding additional species to these data sets, working out and getting that other new species sequence to see if the pattern holds, and then also an additional polyphemus form, another distinct genetic lineage, so we can look at over these rapid sort of evolutionary timescales, are things evolving the same way? And also again, those opsin expression patterns suggest that there's something unique about the eyes. Looking to see where those genes are expressed in and how the eyes, the actual internal morphology, the anatomy of the eyes changing as it's being reduced. That's the next big step for at least the vision side of this. So So with that, thanks to many people who have contributed to this project. Peter and Anne again, who have really been wonderful in supporting science of this area and the cave surveys and the biology. Tom and Vita as well. All of the Ocean View cave owners who have allowed us to access their properties. Pat Biley, who's TNC on Maui and has helped us out even though we haven't found species there yet. He's been very helpful in our efforts to do so. The Hawaii Cave Conservancy, Nature Conservancy, and University of Hawaii. With that, I'm going to take questions.